Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
Can I ask you a question, Captain Calrissian?
Anything, Han?
It's Han, but that's okay. I heard a story about you. I was wondering if it's true.
Everything you've heard about me is true.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to the STABcast, the Sunsphere Tactical Attack Brigade's Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm Tim Stuck-in-a-Rut Hannon, with Ryan Blinded by the Power Solowski. Ben actually plays Legion Fowler, and Will What's a Legion Heim. How's everyone doing, gentlemen? It's been a while.
Who are you people, and why am I here?
Yes. So this is a game called Legion, Will.
Is it like X-Wing?
No.
It is sort of kind of.
Is it like Marvel Crisis Protocol?
Maybe. We have yet to see. Maybe one day. But
maybe someday. Only on the Doom posters counts.
It is so, so weird that I'm the guy who played more games of Legion in the last 2 weeks.
That's like, also true. To me. Yeah.
I don't believe any of
why
this.
Why am I blinded by power like more than usual?
Oh,
like,
because I'm confused by the intro. You won't recognize that Rebels are the most powerful faction in the game right now.
They're not.
That's okay.
Oh, okay. You're the only person on this earth that says that, but that's
okay. That's fine.
Ryan loves when he thinks he's the only person with an opinion.
Yes, because contrarian is definitely a personality trait, but it's okay. Yeah. We'll just keep going.
Well, right. There's lots of people in the critical community for all sorts of things that contrarianism is their motive.
Oh, and I'm sure someone's already typing, they've already said, at Tim Hannon, you're wrong. I don't think Rebels are the strongest either. Well, guess what? Person typing right now, you're also wrong. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, calm down, take off that fedora together. And go outside.
Yeah. Well, they don't have to go outside, Will. They have a bus. They can just ride the bus around.
They can just ride the bus, yes.
That's right.
Take off your fedora, put down your duster, stop tweeting us.
Put down the bowcaster.
Put get the off katana the bus. Back in the sheath.
Wow, we may have lost some listeners on that.
That's fine.
Yeah, I think y'all did, yeah.
Well, for those who are left, this week on the 83rd episode of the STABcast, somehow, battle reports, return of the Tauntauns, what? Invader League, and much, 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 much?
No.
More.
Are there Tauntauns this episode?
Yeah, I don't know.
They're written there.
What's going on?
Well, so since I have played two games in the past 2 weeks, more than anyone else on the podcast.
Tauntauns?
100% where? Return on it for you.
I'm cashing in my chip where I'm allowed to just talk about Tauntauns, even though I didn't play against them.
Ah, yes.
Oh,
Rebels
gotcha. That's
are the most
works.
Powerful faction. Right. Listen, the most Rebels are the most powerful faction that isn't playing Tauntauns when they could be, because they have so many other overpowered things to play. So.
That is how we talk about clones, the previous
one overpowered throne holder.
But the clones. Oh, you have one overpowered thing? Really? Really? Oh,
God. I would say one overpowered, but the rest are very, very powerful.
Yeah.
So, I make that joke, but then I played two games, and I played both against Imperial List, and they were both incredibly difficult games for me.
Not sure that puts you in a great light.
I think that's more of a you problem, homie.
Yeah.
It could be. Now, I will admit, I was trying a brand new list.
Okay.
So,
like a battle report.
Look at you doing new things, being a brave lad.
I am. Trying to be a brave lad, trying to get out there. Because I have said before, I don't play Dooku well. I haven't played him enough, and I was like, you know what?
I thought you were just going to say I don't play Legion. But yeah, go on.
Oh, yeah. No, he's the resident expert right now.
Yeah, I am. In the last three months, I have played, seven games of Legion? So, I'll take that.
So, Ben, what's the experience with the curved hilt?
So, I did, Count Dooku. Curved hilt, and because it's the old style plastic, it has also melted in my bag a little bit. So, the lightsaber itself is also curved.
No! I made that model beautiful for you.
You did, but it's the heat and the plastic, man. Like try to reform it a little bit, but it
move somewhere else.
Ben, as a 40-year-old, you should know that happens sometimes. It's all right.
It happens to an older gentleman.
Yeah, it happens.
It's perfectly.
It never happened to Christopher Lee. Not till the day he died.
That's right.
So
even then,
I tried this list: Count Dooku.
I hear that's
force choke, force push, force reflexes, strict orders.
So much force.
Maul.
You said
force
words.
Push,
yeah.
Saber throw, tenacity, offensive, defensive stance.
Okay.
I had two B1s with the E5C trooper. That's the one that throws the three block dice. I had one rocket trooper with an HQ uplink.
Well, aren't you
and
bold?
I had two naked B1s. So no B2s in sight.
Good.
And I also had two BX snipers.
Yeah, with Dooku, those points get tight.
It's a little hard. And of course, since I had Maul, you have to bring the DRKs. I keep not putting, the command, comms unit so I can flip things over from the Sith probe droid. But right. Also, the Sith probe droid is almost never in range to order anything, like to be ordered or to get orders. So that's the thing that happens.
Sad probing noises.
The idea is that I want to have two Jedis and I want to do cool two Jedi things. And the B1s are there for objectives. It's pretty much the same battle deck I was using previously. So the job is to destroy things with those two guys and then shoot things where we need to. I don't have a great response for real heavy armor, I'll be honest. The rocket is always not that great for those kind of things. And lightsaber, you just have to get next to the vehicle in order to do it.
Sure.
So that means, I don't have a great response in this list to, say, a T-47. I do not.
That's first fair. Thing,
well, thank God those are also popular.
B1s aren't terrible against T-47s, honestly, like if you throw enough dice at it.
There's too many of them.
That's a take, ladies and gentlemen. That's a take from Ryan Sawoski.
Insert B1s Ryan's take about the white dice having the same crits as hits. Herder.
Yeah. I mean, of other core trooper options.
Well, the problem is I can't get through the cover. So when you only throw 6 white dice in, I think it's a red, black, black. If you only get 3 hits, you can't use the impact 2 because 2 of them are blocked by cover.
Well, they should just airspeeders just have cover 1. So
until you bring in the pilot.
But then, yeah.
Yes,
and then if you happen to, on the surging, to block the 1 hit. So,
Yeah, yeah, that's fair.
Yeah. So, but I was like, okay, it's an interesting list. It's 10 activations. So I don't feel bad about that. Mm-hmm. They're good activations. I like the Sith probe droid.
Yeah, they're all quality activations. Except for your naked B1s, but you need naked cores.
It's been a while since I've been able to make
sometimes
it out to
it's
the
nice
Wednesday
to be
play night.
Naked.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, some days. But I've been on fall break, so this is cool. So I got to go out to the Wednesday play night, and so I got to play against Christian, new local player.
Ah, so you got to test before. Your list on a new person.
Oh, yeah, he went for the new guy. So
hang on.
Bullying.
Okay.
Hold up. Why did I go with the new guy? Because I was going to play you.
Because you're a
bitch. I was going to play Ryan. Ryan.
Yeah.
And then
we haven't played in forever.
Then Keith Holt shows up and he says some words to Ryan.
Yeah.
Which he basically just says, Ryan, are you chicken? And, Slowoski being
Polish
and from New Orleans was like, well, shit, now I got to play.
my intention was Christian wanted to make sure he had a game since he was driving. And I knew Keith was going to be there. And I was like, you know what? I just played Keith in the tournament a little while ago. I'll play Christian, Ben and Keith can play. And then Keith looks at me and he calls me chicken.
He does.
So you ignored him and were the bigger man about it.
And I believe the direct quote was pick a table, bitch. And we'll get to my battle report in a minute.
Now, Christian, new player to the building, he had the unfortunate thing happen to him the week before. The opposing player dumped 24 clone fire-supported dice on his Palpatine.
I was there. Would do such a thing. I remember. Now, to be fair, it did take a couple of dice dumps to kill Palp. Palp held on pretty well. I'll give him
that's
credit.
Cool. The gods frown on such things. We don't appreciate those things in our local meta. And so I think, according to the reports, that he didn't get like 4 or 5 hits. Palp did not die, which was super amazing. And then he blocked like a champ. So
yeah, he held on for a long time.
But, it's not that that's disheartening, although it can be. Christian came out, he wants a good game. He wanted to feel like he was doing well and learning.
Sure.
And so he's playing this week, Iden, 2 Death Troopers, a set of ISFs, a single bike, an E-Web, and Storms with all the DLTs.
That is such a roller coaster of approval from me. Iden, Death Troopers, God, no! And then, just going up and down, bikes, yeah! Oh,
yeah. I get it. And so I kind of actually like what he did because with my deck, with my battle deck, what I'm looking for are things that will draw us in close to lots of damage. And so does he. He's looking to get to that range 2 alpha strike kind of thing.
He wants to blow you away.
He wants to just blow me up. Now, we managed to get hemmed in, intercept transmissions, and war weary. We were playing the new 4-card setup, which was really weird to me.
I loved it. Yeah.
Very strange. I mean, I liked it, but
it's
it was
so
also
good. But it's you have to relearn it, really. The way you think about turn 0 is completely redone. On paper, you think, okay, I'll just have to think about it as a little bit different. Nope. The whole process has changed. The whole thing.
Yes. Absolutely. So we end up with that Hindim intercept transmissions war weary, and he does something I should have expected, and I honestly didn't. Suddenly, Aiden, he drops like with the first drop. Like I put down a B1, and then he's like, "Hey, we'll measure this real fast. Range 3, blamp, Aiden." I was like, "Oh no, this is gonna be real bad." Next thing you know, ISFs are like right behind it. Like so, he's infiltrating super hard.
He is among you. Direction.
He is among us. Yes, absolutely. And then he puts his bikes and his E-Web on the other side of Hemden, because I'm blue player, of course.
Uh-huh.
And then I'm like, oh, I may lose Dooku here if I don't have great cover. Like, I did not choose the appropriate side of the board for Hemden. I'll be real honest. I did not choose correctly.
You fool.
And I was like, oh. So I had to kind of, like, sit there and, like, oh, they're going to have to just hide for a turn or two until I can get them in place to do the stuff. And he, of course, does exactly the alpha strike that he needs to. So I have lost, well, I've lost a lot of bodies. I hadn't lost a lot of units. B1s go flying off the board left and right. I have one unit get down to just the commander. I got one unit down to two. I mean, they're just getting lit up. But it's intercept transmission. So I'm holding him off from the sides there. It's like, we're pushing real hard on it. So we can't grab the things he would like to grab. Not intercept transmission. My apologies. Sabotage. It was sabotage.
Okay.
Sorry. Back the train up. Boop, boop, boop. I'll replace it. It was sabotage, which makes a difference here because that's why he was infiltrating on top of them.
Okay.
So the problem is I have to run into Aiden, and it's just gross. Like, it's just not a great thing I can do. But I have bag control, so I make sure that Maul goes last, and so does Dooku. And then I manage to start a turn two. I get Dooku out. I take a unit. I force push or I attack the unit, throw some things out. I get them to scatter, which puts them within range one of me to then force push to drag them closer. So my next activation, Maul can leap out, and zoom, 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 which is exactly what he does. And then Maul and Dooku just dance across the middle and just light everything up until an unlucky Dooku, and then he just dies.
Yeah, I was about the time I walked over from my game, and I just got to watch Dooku get dumped on.
Yeah. Just like, oh, look, there's Dooku. I can block it. It's fine. It's red dice. Blankskis. Clip at. Just
old. Yeah, it was like five hits into a three health Dooku or something like that, and it was just like, here's four blanks and a surge.
But the first two turns, Christian is lighting me up. And because it is sabotage, like, we've got to get close enough. We got to get to the thing. He and I are fighting kind of with the closest one to both of us. There's one I just have to shoot at. And because it's war weary, I managed to get enough suppression on some units. I actually panicked a full set of DTs right off the board.
Rude. Just
pushed him so far away. Yeah, it was. I managed to keep some stormtroopers away because of that. Because War Weary is a really tight bubble,
but and we don't have that command so strong. Range.
You especially did this to, if you're you did this to our new friend.
So here's the thing: it literally came down to kill points because he managed to get.
Of course, it did. It's sabotage.
It's sabotage.
It did, but I only won by little. Like, he took me all the way to the mat. It was a very good game.
It's sabotage, and no one has R2-D2. There you go.
Yes. Forgot that part. There you go. That's exactly it. No R2-D2 in sight.
Well, and also...
if only you went to Cad Bane.
To put some perspective, how far... You guys didn't particularly get all that far in your game either, did you?
No, we didn't. We got to, I think, round three. We did.
Yeah.
So I actually got to the store early. I set up all the mats because I had the time. Like, I was there at 4 o'clock.
Yeah, you were. Good on you.
And then no one else was there to, like, 5:45. So by the time we actually got our game started, it was about 6:30. And this is why I'm always hesitant to come out during a work week when I'm working, because I don't get out of work that early. Like, I can get to the store by 6:30. It is hard to play a full game of Legion, shut it down, and be out by 9.
Yeah, that's true.
And the lovely teenage child that replaced Will when he quit the game store, she's like, all right, guys, 10 minutes, I'm kicking you out. And she was very stern about it. She's a very small lady, but she's very stern about it. So we left.
She is small, but she will throw you out of the store.
Very powerful. Very powerful.
Yes.
I'm pretty sure she could take the manager Walt, just be honest.
Oh, yes.
Betting in a fight.
I mean.
Yeah.
One day she will decapitate him for his power, like Highlander.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? I mean.
The trick is to marry someone who's at shanking distance, or like shanking height. And then that's perfect. There you go. Like, the small ones can just get you right in the kidneys. That's
filled with rage and all the really blood sensitive spots where they just bleed
out. Well, they know where to go. Your wife knows all the spots.
Yeah, she knows exactly where to cut, where it will wound but not kill.
Yes.
Unless she wants you to.
So Christian and I had a good conversation when we played. Like, it was a very fun experience. Like I said, he took me to task in the first two rounds. And then he and I were talking through his plays on the other rounds. There was a place where he wanted to move to shoot me. But then if he had, then he would have not have gotten the extra damage on the sabotage. So mm-hmm. we walked that backwards and kind of talked through, like, yeah, this is where if you do that, I'm going to win the game automatically. So, so then we kind of stepped that backwards for him. And then he still managed to shoot me in the face. So
right, yeah, yeah, as one does.
So, like I said, fantastic game, had a great experience, won that game. Cool, cool. Next week, I come back out. Hey, let's go see what's going on here. Brett had decided to stay at my house. He had a wedding to go to, and so I let him use my guest bedroom. I didn't actually see Brett at all. He came into my home, left silently. I left before he came. He woke up that next morning because I had to go to work and do some things. And so, yeah. So Brett shows up. We're trying to figure out who we're playing. And then Scott Marler walks in the door and calls me his opponent. So, you know, the last time Scott and I played, he brought Lat Vader, terrified me. I've been talking about it on the podcast for, you know, the last three episodes. This week, what does Scott bring?
I Lat bet Vader. It's a Lat Vader, yeah.
It's actually the exact same list. He hasn't changed it whatsoever. So we play the new four-card setup. It gets to be key positions hemmed in fortified positions, which was pretty good because the map kind of needed it. Problem is, with hemmed in, he doesn't care. He's going to put that Lat with Vader on the one side and yep. everyone else on the other side.
Man, it's a week full of hemmed in, man.
I was consulted on this decision. Yay!
You were.
Go me!
All right, so everything's kind of well. I've got some good blocking spots, but when I realize Vader is going to come zooming in from my right,
yeah,
and I've got Maul on my left to go take care of Kallus, like, I have to make Dooku stay in the middle. Like, I want Dooku to go wade into those troopers and tear them all up, but then Vader's in my back line just eating my B1s left and right.
Yeah, yep.
So I'm like, okay, we can do this. We can do this. We got this, guys. Maul hops out from behind a building, does some really nice spinny tricks. He managed to throw his lightsaber into Kallus to get four hits, and he blocked none of them. Just ew. None. Just blip. So I was like, woohoo! And then I don't manage to kill him again. I spend the next three rounds shooting at Kallus. He refuses to die. Like, it's just, he lives and it shouldn't, but he does. Wait, I'm tearing up his troopers.
Does Kallus surge on defense?
No, I do not believe he does.
I've never played him in my life, so I'm not sure. I just don't.
Kallus is really good. I'll be real honest. Yeah. Kallus is really good, and I think people are sleeping
gets,
on him.
He gets block.
Yeah.
Okay. He does get block.
On like a one push.
These are cool.
He has cunning, so that's always nice.
Okay.
I mean, his flaw card, I mean, I got to play his flaw card, but then I actually did manage to kill him. I killed him before he got to do anything. So
stake on Scott's part, it seems like.
he kept moving him, and I just happened to get a B1 unit who just happened to throw some dice who threw a single crit. He didn't manage to block with one red die.
Yeah, it happens.
I mean, I think I had five suppression on him before the card came down. Like, yeah, I had shot him a whole bunch and he just refused to die. But it was because Vader was taking his sweet time. That Lat was always drawn last. Like, he wasn't even ordering the thing. It was just there until it was time to order Vader. So then next thing you know, there the Lat appears. It's in the middle of my place in key positions on the center point. And Vader just hops out. And he just... The Lat had great dice shooting things. Vader appears. Scott did an amazing play, which I kind of wish I had recorded, in which he took a unit, slapped it up, took another unit, force-pushed it backwards, so they couldn't get close enough to shoot the thing I needed to shoot, and also couldn't walk towards the key position.
Gross.
He forced them backwards into a terrain piece that we had said was difficult terrain. So it slowed me down. Like, it was a beautiful play. And he kept me just slightly out of range of Dooku. So to get my Dooku to the place where I needed him to be took a lot of actions, in which, you know, which is less attacks, which is less other things I was trying to do. Now, I do eventually kill Lord Vader. Dooku turns out to be much better than Vader. He was actually a master on the council.
It's true.
Boom.
But it took two turns to do it. Took two turns for Dooku to do it. Dooku, of course, at this point is near half dead. Dooku took two turns to take care of it, but he's about half dead himself when I finally kill Vader. And the Lat hasn't been touched. And because it's key positions, and the Lat doesn't have speeder, he just moves sideways.
Yep.
Stands right next to it. So I'm like, okay, it's one to one. That's fine. I can wait that way. But he has this one lone naked stormtrooper squad just trying their best to get over there. and we're dancing around. I've lost most of my army, but I've got two guys on my points. He's got no guys on his. Like, I'm trying to fight to get there, and I just can't make it. Like, there's just one action too many. You know, we're headed towards the 9 o'clock hour, and I just can't do it. So Scott wins 2-1 with his Lat Vader list.
So Vader, you want to beat Ben, bring Lat Vader.
Apparently, I just have
0-2 against it. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like Scott has made fantastic plays with that Vader using all the things you can do with Vader.
Yeah.
Like, that's really the thing. Like, that, it's just he knows he's figured out exactly where to push things in the right direction to make it harder. It's not engaging. It's not jumping into the pile of bodies and slamming them. It's actually pushing things away to make it harder, which was like a brilliant play on his part.
No, and that's the cool thing about Legion is the armies themselves are pretty, you know, asymmetrical in how different they are. But even every army has a bunch of different ways you can play it. And I'm going to rag on Scott and then congratulate him. When Scott was playing that, like, quad infiltrate nonsense list that he was for a while... That was not Scott's playstyle.
No,
he would get too aggressive. He would take the middle of the board, but then not have ways to hold it against. At least in my experience, because I play Rebels, we got lots of Pierce ways to peel him off of it. And Luke, he couldn't hold it. But like I've watched a handful of games with Scott and this Vader Lat list, and he just like if you were to show me the games without players. I wouldn't have thought those were the same two players because he's found a list and a bunch of ideas that just gel with the way that he wants to think and play about the game. And he does it really, really well. And so instead of immediately recognizing sometimes that an army may not be good or a unit may not be good or bad, sometimes you just got to find your shtick and find something that really works with the way you do. And that took me, in a lot of senses, a long time, and it changes periodically.
And you tend to choose the things that other people aren't playing because it's just not your – like the meta is not your style.
Right.
It hasn't been – yeah. It normally isn't your style. Right now the bus is the meta because it's all buses. But yeah. Beforehand.
It's meta, but also I'd argue that right now we're in a spot where there's not really like a firm meta.
There's not. No, the meta doesn't
there is, matter. But there isn't at the same time.
Yeah, but yeah, Ryan, well, you're the person who's still playing X-34s and have been since they came out.
We're in flux. True.
You could drive two buses, but you're not driving two buses.
I'm not driving two buses. You're
driving an X-34.
So yeah, good on you, Scott. Good on you.
Not only did I get to play two games of Legion, I also got to play some X-Wing. So that was nice. That was fun. Enjoyable times.
Hey, that's the game I've been playing.
Exactly.
Traitor!
Oh, I mean, hush.
X-Wing came first.
All right.
Yeah.
Which came first, the Legion or the X-Wing? But the X-Wing. We found a game I'm good X-Wing. At, guys.
Yes, it's the X-Wing.
I know. I'm good at, so we forget the other one.
Yeah, I've been enjoying the X-Wing's kind of the had a bit of a... Yes, the Wang. Embraced the Wang.
But, Will, what about the Legion you've played?
I haven't.
Okay.
Yeah, I haven't played a game of Legion since Dallas, probably.
Oh my God. So what you're saying is you're more attracted to playing the game that's recently gotten points, errata, rules, and tournament structure updates?
Oh. Yes, it's had a very interesting new support thing released for it, and that's reinvigorated the community to play the game more.
Wow, it's amazing how that works, LFL.
What a strange effect.
Now, we are going to sound like asses back to Legion. Because by the time this comes out, all of those things very well may be true.
No, listen, we all know what we've been through. It's fine.
Yeah, for sure.
And we'll get into the
nuts and bolts of that here in a minute.
Yeah,
But Tim, how do you not want to play X-Wing? The bid doesn't matter anymore.
Oh, I do. I just don't have the time right now.
The bid literally isn't like Ben posted his list in our notes here, and I went, "Why does it have a bid?" Because my brain has just been on no bid mode for X-Wing for the past 2 months.
So I built a list to play X-Wing. Will wasn't there. I was playing Seneca and our friend David. Uh-huh. And David was like, how many points do you have? I was like, yeah, I'm at this. He's like, oh, you know, you can spend up to 200. I was like, oh, yeah. So I went and found some piece of equipment because I had about 8 points to spare. And so I found that a piece of equipment that was going to work well. And it did stuff. Did some nice things for me. I mean, it was quite
delightful. That is my
only real problem. We were going for initiative.
Yep.
X-Wing has had an interesting discussion of how previously everything you spent points on had to be weighted against the value of what the bid would earn you
Yeah.
And now it's like, oh, well, I mean, I wouldn't have bought this before, but now this 4-point card is like pretty cool.
Yep.
Yeah.
The prophet has been speaking on the mountaintop here, and now we want to bring the word to Legion now, please. One day. Although we've made changes.
I don't know that it's going to work right as well in Legion.
You would say that, but that's fine. I believe that it would
they
work
are different
well,
games.
I don't know if we'll ever see it. We've made right
we
changes.
We say that, but you know, really, each turn is done by your command hand. So initiative matters for board placement, selection, and all that kind of stuff. But and cunning. I mean, it does theoretically affect cunning, but you end up rolling off for that anyway. So I don't know. I think you could probably do a roll off to see who gets blue player and then arrest that setup. I mean, I can see it if bids don't matter anymore.
Well,
and
I
then everyone's spending all the points.
I think going forward, now that we're going to get a 4-card flip and red player chooses side, and I will say for the battle reports that I'll give here in a minute, and I know Ben's game against Christian, we did it incorrectly because they told us about the 4-card flip, but when we played those games, they had not told us that red player picked side yet.
Yeah.
So we did do a 4-card flip with blue player picking table edge because it's the information we had at the time. Well, yeah. But now that...
And in retrospect, I chose poorly, so...
Yeah. But now that red player picks table edge, I can honestly either A, depending on your list, and I'll try not to go off on too big of a tangent here, I can see you bidding for red. Because if you have the bid in Legion, it's not that you're blue player, it's you get the option of blue player. And if you're taking a battle deck or your list is good at a battle deck that you think is going to share 75% of the cards with your opponent, I think in some cases the board edge is way more valuable because there's a finite number of different battle deck combinations while there's an infinite number of table configurations.
Yeah. I don't think you're completely like wrong there. I think it does depend a lot on the map as far as like,
I think it depends on the list and the map. And when you see your opponent's list, if you think like, hey, I'm going to have most of the same battle cards, I'll play red.
Right. But like, hopefully for a map, it shouldn't matter, but that's
my
opinion.
I'll be honest. Like I've taken out Bombing Run because I didn't want to have other lists have it. Because I didn't play as well with it as my opponents could, like Hostage Exchange. Clone players just play it better since most of them are having some form of Rex. Like it's harder for me. So I took it out of my deck. But if it's something I feel like I could do, like you know what your opponent's kind of probably
to kind of steer this back to the bid versus no bid and just randomly roll kind of context. In X-Wing, like obviously table edge doesn't really matter. Objective cards don't really matter. But it had a how to bring this point home. There's a reason in Legion to bid for both. Not every list is going to take advantage of that, but there is a reason to bid for both. And so I think as long as that decision is there, bids are still needed.
No, that's fair. I think that's accurate. And I will say too, like as much as I like a balanced table, I think you can have, and this is a whole separate conversation, but you can have a balanced table without having a mirrored table. And also that means that you might have one side. Let's say I'm bringing an ST. Okay, I might have to, or I might want a side that, you know, the ST can see over because there might be line of sight on both sides, but maybe this line of sight over here on this side is a little bit more advantageous to my ST sitting behind or something like that.
Whenever I build tables don't have to be symmetrical. And I'll be honest, like I tend to make them more symmetrical than I would care to admit. But I do think you need to sit down and look at each table edge and be like, well, what type of list likes this side? Does an armor list really like this side because it's got lower stuff that the tanks can zoom over? Does an infantry list like this side? Does a infiltrate list? And they don't have to like all of the same things, but as long as a player showing up to your event can find an advantage on one of the two table edges, then then you've made a good table.
Yeah. No, that's fair. I think that's fair.
Well, if Will didn't play any Legion,
nope.
I happen to know that the night that I was out to play Legion, there were not one, not two, but three CIS players that day.
Whoa. Oh, my. Oh, gross. Who would do such a thing?
It was me and, of course, our good buddy Landon, who plays CIS. It was natural to expect such a thing.
Yes, yes, yes.
And then, perhaps, some form of, you know, gingery man appeared with his gingery army. to robot it up. They called it.
Wow. A robot army. Wow, that's crazy. It's almost like that kind of guy who hadn't changed his list in the 3+ games he's played because he's just been too busy and didn't know what else to do with his life. So there we go. Yes.
Listen, what were you doing last Saturday night? Tennessee wasn't something. Winning. It was fine. You had plenty of time then. You had plenty
of
time.
I was shouting is what it was. I was at that game.
You had a 15-minute time break between the end of that game and the actual end of that game. No, you could have redone that list.
I was there. We're not going down that road. That's fine. both sides threw their things. But anyway, that's fine. I did get to play finally because it's been a minute. And I got to play against the Raccoon Man, the Badger Man, I guess, because Raccoon's taken. But the Badger Man himself, who's come up from the Dirty Nuga to haunt our halls. He was staying with Ben, and he played a interesting double RT with Flamers. So, of course, basically made for droids. Yeah, made for droids. Uh-huh. double RT Flamers with double Mando. No Clan Ren. But it was Lando, okay, double like Mando, it. Which I just like the sound of that. Lando, double Mando. No Sabine, and then it's just, you know, some troopers and whatnot to fill. It was actually, I think he said, the first time he's gotten to use Flamers against droids, which was fun for him. So good for him. Yeah.
So he's tried it against me, I think, once, and I just politely declined and run away.
Oh, right.
I just shoot it till it's dead so he can't do it. So.
Yeah, I was just saying, he's tried before, but this is the first time he's actually gotten like to roll the dice on it and be like, yay, I do it. It wasn't actually that effective for him, but that's okay. And I was playing droids. I was playing the same list I've been playing, like I said, because I've not really had too much time to dedicate to changing things. I was playing Maul and Grievous together because it is actually a lot of fun. I will say, I wouldn't argue it's competitive, but it's fun. It's a lot of fun.
Sure. Yeah. That's two of the most aggressive, probably the two most aggressive pieces in the game.
Maul, Grievous, and then one unit of B2s with the Ha, and then the rest were B1s.
There's a bunch of, you're like 560 B1s. Points.
right. Yeah. With some couple of E5Cs, you know, Maul's buddy bots are there with him, all those things. And we played Long March, which was hilarious because it was Long March VAPS. And so it was just the first, with limited viz, no less. Not that limited viz mattered because neither side had a sniper unit. No one could shoot beyond range three.
So you had two turns where you could tap your sabots.
It was literally just two turns of like, hey, I'm going to tap this. Okay, I'm going to tap this and run. All right. Next, move. So the first two turns were great. They were quick. And then,
so then you just murdered each other.
Well, then we clashed. I mean, his RT came in, did some damage against a B2, but really not as much as you would hope, but because it was stuck kind of shooting a B2 instead of a B1 squad, and it wasn't quite as effective against the B2. So it killed a B2, but that's about it. It chipped away, but I mean, the B2 unit was alive at the end of the game. And then the other Flamer kind of made like an odd turn and never really got a shot off. It was kind of distraction. And really, if we were to do this in the dice sim, I would imagine I probably do okay. I didn't have a huge amount of impact, but I had the Ha guys, and then I had a whole bunch of B1s shooting two RTs, which are, they're not clone RTs, so don't surge on defense. So you figure, okay, rolling for crits should be fine. I had lots of aims from, you know, free aims and things like that. I just didn't, you know, AI doesn't matter because it's a joke. And so you're just taking aims and shooting the RTs. And they would not die. His white dice were rolling like 50-50 on that. Like he was,
that's wild.
He was insane.
They blocked all sorts of things. And of course, they blocked all. And you could hear Brett like, that's not a thing that's supposed to happen. But
like I would get a decent roll, which again, like you're rolling a bunch of white dice. So you really can't like hope for much, which is fine. So I get a couple crits. I'm like, oh, look at that. It's great. And you just be like, no, I'm not taking any damage. Like, okay. All right. at one point, I did finally break one of them. And, of course, I chose the Flamer, but it never came into effect. But anyway, that was that side. And then the interesting thing was also, the more interesting thing to me, really, was the Maul Grievous versus Mandos. Grievous ran into some Mandos, and I had a great die roll in there. Tapped O-push, got some aims in there, did all the things. Mm-hmm. It was like on his one-pip turn, and he had really a solid roll. I mean, it wasn't all hits, but it was close to it. And Impervious came in and just said, no, thank you. And he took, I think, one wound after, like, I had, like, eight hits or something. It was a really good roll, and it was just nope. Just a nope. That made Grievous very sad. But Grievous was engaged, so that was okay. And then Maul, I knew full well what I was doing with Maul, and I dove him in there, and he kind of did the job. He dove into one of the Mando squads and just murdered it, and then jumped to another Mando squad and like did some damage to that. It was a good time. Maul died, but he died a hero, so it was okay. All that to say, to try to sum that all up, I think, I'm not saying he's better, but for me, I think I actually like Grievous better. I'm not saying he's better objectively. I'm saying for my style.
I can see that.
The way I play, I think I like Grievous a little better. Of course, you miss the force push. That's the big thing.
Right.
But I mean, like, he took some with his dice, and like, I like running Vigilance Grievous because you take a dodge in the beginning turns and then you just keep it with you until you need it again. Some turns you'll have two dodges because of his cards. And so, like,
sure.
He was fine. Like, he took some hits, and he. At one point, I did roll 5 red dice on defense, and I was surging on defense because I spent a dodge, and I got 1 block and 4 blanks. And I was like, oh, okay. So
that's. But you got 8 hit points to back you up, so.
That happened. Yeah, that killed him, though.
Yeah.
Because everything else has been, like, chip damage. So when you get chip, and then a huge swing like that, it kind of does you in. But it's just interesting. Again, the big takeaway from that is... I'm not saying at all that Maul is bad. I think Maul is very good, but Maul is very fragile.
Maul is definitely a finesse piece.
Yeah.
And Grievous is a little bit more, like, not a little bit. He is probably the epitome of, like, brute force.
Yes, which I
And that is the way that you like to play, and I'm not trying to, like, insult you by saying that.
I feel that backhand on my cheek, but that's fine. Like, you know.
No, but that's what he is. Like, he's a big pool of health, a big pool of dice, some survivability, but he doesn't have a ton of cool tricks that he can do other than really scale, but even that is used just to get into the thick faster.
No, that's true. That's absolutely true. Well, and I think the big thing we could... Maybe that would increase GG's playability is... I know everyone's talking about points and all those things. I think the easiest thing, honestly, would just give him like a upgrade pack or something with some more command cards. Like, that would be, give him 3 new
command cards. Oh, I think for a lot of our starter box and wave early wave commanders, that would be really cool.
Yeah.
But I think Grievous will start to see a little bit more play, maybe. I imagine with the prevalence of Maul and CIS lists, he might get an increase. And I think with Grievous not being seen anywhere at all, I do think he's definitely due for a decrease. And I would just like it to be, like, Grievous doesn't have to be amazing, but I'd love for it to be an option.
And then 2 other things I'd take away. A is relentless on him is cash money. Like, the fact that it's relentless and absolutely not charge.
Because
everyone's like, oh, he has relentless charge, but same thing. No. Relentless for him is a huge difference because that means he can still do something on the approach. But then other big thing is I think I finally landed on doing Maul saber throw because there's just too many times where I get stuck where, like, I can't do anything. Like, you're a hair short.
Yeah. And no, it just ends up costing you. Since Maul doesn't have relentless or charge, like, I think saber throw is a really good option because it increases his already really flexible kit with 3 actions.
Right.
And
choke is good. Don't get me wrong. Choke is good. But my big problem that I had too, and Brett and I talked about this after the game, my biggest problem is I probably really should have switched Grievous and Maul's placement because one was on one side, the other was on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
And because the problem is that Maul couldn't engage with the flame RTs. And so because he couldn't engage with the RTs, he would have left himself open to a side shot from the Mandos. And he doesn't have the health to give up for that kind of shot that Grievous does. Grievous could take the shot and keep going, which he did. Maul can't get away with that. So it was just a simple placement switch, and I think it would have been a different game, but that's all right. It was fun. That's cool. A good game. It was a fun game.
I mean, I honestly, even if you lose a game, as long as you can identify something to learn from it, it wasn't a bad game.
Yeah.
I'll be honest. I think you bring the cost of his gun down.
That's fair.
5 points.
Yeah.
I think that, because that gun's really what gets you that relentless on the approach, but it's 12 points, which is a lot. I mean, put you at 70, or 187 points, plus whatever upgrade you put on him. Yeah,
that's but then we need a Grievous flaw card where he drops his gun and you get to shoot him with it and his heart explodes in a ball fire.
So uncivilized.
No, it would just be called. You beat me to it, you Obi-Wan son of a bitch.
If anyone needs to make the joke, card. It's Will. Come on, now.
There you go. It's the flaw card's name. It's done. It's already set in stone. There you go.
Yep.
Please don't give Grievous a flaw card. Please, God.
Please, yeah, he was down 15 this, points.
His flaw is... Give him a flaw. His flaw card is just lull. His courage is 2.
No, yeah. His flaw card does nothing. Is his command cards. This is what his flaw card is. But that's
it, his command cards are driven to do exactly one thing. I'm going to protect my commander with my 2 pip. Is that gets him close enough to do his awesome 1 pip.
Yes.
And then hopefully you've murdered some things and just live long enough to give the crush to them before he then dies.
Yeah.
It's true. My big thing, his 1 pip and his, what is that, his 3 pip are fine. Whatever one that gives the whatchamacallit.
The surge guardian. For every defeated enemy unit.
See, that's the problem. So
hard to pull. I like crush his 2 pip. Group,
though. No, that's his 2 pip. I don't know. What is your own crush one? Crush them is so bad. It is so bad.
Crush them's a 3 pip.
Yeah.
It is so bad. Because you never get to pull it off.
You need to be towards the end of the game. And at that point, Grievous probably shouldn't still be on the table. If he is, you probably have won anyway. Like, it's a win card.
It's a win more card,
It's such, like, when every time I've played with that card, I literally ignore the text. And I'm just like, okay, but it does order, like, 2 troopers or something like that.
I think it gets a little bit better if you pair him with some BX snipers to, like, because they're good at finishing activations early.
Sure.
I would also really like the card to maybe say units ordered by this card get 1 surge token plus 1 surge token for every defeated enemy unit, so they get something no matter when you play it. Yeah.
You get a little aggressive tactics out of it,
Yeah.
That would definitely be a nice addition to that.
It's not a great card, but I do think some of the newer releases that can pick that are better at picking up activations like BXs and STABs can be really good to help that card, because just like B1's trying to finish off, you know, 2 rebel troopers with a dodge token behind a rock, I'm like, good luck.
But anyway, so it was a fun game. Learned a lot.
Traitorous Tim, you're on your third faction. You have gone through the factions.
Like
many a metaphor I could use right here.
Yes, go ahead.
I mean,
ask your question. I was gonna say, I figured that's what the question was, but I was gonna ask. I genuinely miss clones and even Empire too. Like, I just plate wise, I just like Empire better. But droids are a really nice break because I can play them, and because I don't actually love them as much, I can really play them and not care as much. Like, I can really just be like, okay, we're gonna do this, and especially all the white dice, you're like, I'm gonna roll whatever, and it's fun. A couple like cool thematic pieces, you know, that's fun. Like, I don't imagine myself. I mean, financially, I can't anyway, but, like, I don't imagine myself trying to keep up with every single droid release at launch. Whereas for Empire or Clones, I probably will still keep it up like I have been.
Well, there's not a lot left.
I kind of miss playing Empire, honestly. Like, they're mid-repaint right now, so hopefully they'll be done before the RRG, but maybe it'll be after. Who knows? The RRG doesn't exist, so it's okay. But...
The rumored RRG does not exist.
Yes. The alleged Favorite RRG. Text.
Yes.
That's a great rapper name. I'm the alleged RRG. What's up?
So Tim plays next to me, tries to be a droid man, could not pull it off. Landon and I both win our games.
He does not beep or boop.
So,
but the previous week, Ryan is playing next to me in his challenge game against the Keith, who called me a chicken.
He called me a chicken. I let him pick the table. That because of the 2 that Ben had set up, I didn't have as much time that day as I thought. I had a new list I wanted to try out, didn't have time to put it together, so I took my Invader League list that I had previously played Keith with, you know, the Abus and X-34, all the good stuff, Jin, Shriv, and Keith brought a very strange list. It was a list that it felt kind of similar to my Atlantic City list, where it was Cassian, K2, and Op Luke, but where I had Pathfinders and some extra dudes on my infantry. Keith found points for a bus and an FD gun. he's only sitting at 9x. So it was his 9x to my 10. And we go into turn 0, and after turn 0, I am just licking my lips, because I had hostile environment with Jin, you know, who just laughs in 3 pip, hemmed in bombing run, and hemmed in is so hard to play as red player. on bombing run, because the blue player can just kind of see what you're going to do and go the other direction when they put their bomb tokens out. But I will give Keith credit. He made it a game for having a pretty abysmal, in my opinion, turn zero. And I think he just made some misplays. And once again, I think it was his first, maybe second game with the new 4-card flip. So like, that's kind of to be expected. I got all the cards to kind of come up in my favor. I bring Jin on this flanking path where I can see which way his bus is going to go. And I bring my X-34 to hit his FD gun and then get behind his bus. Because I knew the last time me and Keith played, if I let him get his bus anywhere near my X-34, Luke is going to pop out, bonk Jin, and my plans are going to go to hell in a handbasket. Because yep, Keith
as it should, as it should.
Keith was talking trash because I was running my same list that he beat me with. And then on my other flank is where I kind of, and towards the center of the hemmed in area is where I put all of my kind of other big heavy hitters. My bus with my Wookiees in it, R2 kind of hiding behind them, and I had way better bombing run targets in. I put one on R2, one on my bus, and one on my X-34, while Keith had one on his bus and then two on just 4-man Rebel Trooper squads. And he did a really good job of running his two Rebel Trooper squads around some buildings, kind of around the point of my deployment zone, to where I really couldn't engage with them. He had two FD guns, one in either side of the hemmed in deployments, and they were raining down fire. One of them I could not kill for the life of me. My original plan was to have the X-34 fly up, wait for it to activate. The X-34 flies up and kills it. Jin shoots it, and then a sniper shoots it, and hopefully by then it's dead. But it just didn't die to that attack. It survived on like one or two hits, it got two shots off when I really hoped it would only get one. And there was a pretty open center on that table that I had to kind of cross with my army that I had put at the top of the blue player hemmed in zone. And his FDs and Cassian and K2 did, and Luke jumping out of the bus did quite a bit of work. But I did manage to use the Wookiees. They didn't stop Luke, but they put some wounds on him. They slowed him down. Me and Keith got into an activation battle to see who could fish their big melee hitters tokens first. Keith got me there, but then I had some lucky Rebel Trooper shots that put some damage onto Luke. The land speeder comes in from behind and takes out K2 and Cassian. Like, we were just in as you do with bombing run. We're trading each other's flanks, and both of us are kind of rotating our armies clockwise, in a sense, around the table, to the point to where I don't know that Keith makes me drop one of my bombs, and I have to do everything in my power to be able to pick it back up. My bus only lasted two turns under his FD cannons and K2's surge to crit, and, you know, Luke jumping out and hitting it with a lightsaber. So my bus, I made a mistake with my bus, and when I should have dropped a bomb, I didn't. And so I have a bomb sitting in the middle of the table that I then have to, with Jin at the end of the game, Jin has to jump out of the land speeder, pick up, and run it in. But I managed to get Keith's R2. And
something that the UT football team can't do.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so it ended up being a 3-4 victory for me just off of Secret Mission. And so Keith did make it a really good game that if Keith hadn't, we both made a couple of mistakes. I think, honestly, I probably made more mistakes during the game, and Keith made some pretty big mistakes during turn zero. And so while I did run him over with my list and beat him and teach him a lesson for challenging me, he did, with a terrible turn zero, make a really, really, really good game out of it. And I do like that list for Keith. I would try to squeeze one more activation out of it. But, I mean, it's like Luke, a bus, two other heroes, and two FD cannons, which are kind of the hard counters to buses right now. So it was a really fun, wild game. And the reason I love playing with Keith is we did start before Ben. We had about a 15-minute head start. if you listen back to Ben's battle report, about halfway through turn three is when I walked over to Ben's table and me and Keith played all six turns. Keith's a lightning fast player. I love playing with him because there's no downtime, no time to ponder. We just gotta play, and it was a really good game. And
well, so, if you had not had R2-D2,
yes,
do you win on points destroyed?
Yes,
but would you have if your opponent wasn't stuck with R2?
But I'm pretty certain I went on points destroyed.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is what we call the R2 skew. There you go.
Yeah, it's 45 points. Now, you don't get the guaranteed secret mission. Like, nope. You don't always get that
but
point.
But you get right. A guaranteed thing that your opponent has to be worried about.
Yep.
It's no, Keith also did have R2. And okay, that was part of matter. Keith's issue, is he was at 9 activations, one of which was R2.
Yeah.
It's like he had a few big heavy hitters, because he's sitting at like 3 Rebel Troopers, 2 FDs, a bus, and then... I know. I guess he didn't have R2 if he had Luke and Cassian. So no, he did not.
I didn't think he did.
Okay, so back to my point. Hooray!
Yeah, and huzzah. This is one of those like secret mission is awfully good for 45 points and an activation. It's an aggro device.
I agree. I wholeheartedly agree. Now, Tim, prepare to roll your eyes. I think it's less of a problem with Rebels just because there's more operative, like good operative choices. Like there's an opportunity cost to taking R2. You taking R2 means it's harder to take a Luke, it's harder to take a Sabine, it's harder to take a Chewbacca. Like it's not just, well, I'm taking this or Padme. But no, I do agree that R2 does is problematic. And he does need to go up in cost. I think he's a little stronger on the Republic side.
I think up until this bus wiki garbage that we're seeing right now, I would have agreed with you. But
okay,
as it stands, yeah, right now,
since Rebels are taking vehicles now, and vehicles yes. are becoming a because vehicles were not part of the Rebel meta,
right.
No. Before so, the bus showed so, up. So I do and think R2 stock went up because of that. That's a fair
right.
point.
Well, and also, and my argument too is like when I'm facing that kind of list, right, regardless of the win condition, right.
Mm-hmm.
And even the deployment, although the deployment, of course, plays a factor in it. If you're playing sure. like a Wookiee bus list with R2 thrown in there, my problem is I have to focus so much on the Wookiees and the buses. But I mean, it's really the Wookiees inside the buses, more or less, depending on your bus loadout. I have to focus so much on what's in my face that I can't focus on R2 in the backfield. And so you sure. can just march your R2 down there. And if I try and kill him, sure, but that's going to take... heat off of
and
your
in,
Wookiees,
in most examples I would agree with you there. The only reason I would counter in this example is because he had a Luke bus, and so my Wookiee's job was to wait for Luke to get out of the bus and to counter his Luke, where we had kind of switched sides, where
yeah, but he didn't have an R2.
Become a poor man's Luke.
Yeah, I understand that, but yeah,
no still. But my Wookiees aren't jumping into his army. My Wookiees are waiting for him to jump.
But
we're basically, we played chicken with our buses.
Right, right. I hear that. But the point is still the same, is that you're playing that game, and then there's a side, there's a mini game going on over here with R2-D2. And if you don't have the resources to devote to that mini game, you're done.
Sure. Yeah, and the other big issue was I was at 10x, he was at 9, so R2 can go down sure. last. Now, he did have the FDs, which I think are great against R2.
Yep, that's fair.
Can hit him from a lot of different places. He had some great terrain for them. But your point holds, but in our game, he didn't need to so much worry about the Wookiees. He needed to worry about the X-34. Because the X-34 and Jyn, if you just don't, like, towards the mid-game, if it's not dead, it's really hard to muster enough dice to bring it down. Because it's so good at just shrugging chip damage off. But I think your point is right. Yeah, R2, something has to happen to R2. I don't know what it is. I don't know if they need to remove some keywords or just do a full
points
bump. But no, you're 100% right. R2 is an issue.
Well, that's some news right there. We rarely hear Ryan say that.
It's true.
Especially to Tim.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Speaking of those cinematic moments where the opponent agrees with his victim.
Yeah. Tim is my victim. It's true.
Leave it in. Leave it in, you coward.
You're right. Tim sees himself as a victim. Ryan often bullies him as a villain. And we'll keep it. Be sure to check out the Instagrams where I actually took photos of Scott just beating the tar out of me once again with that LAAT.
Because
Vader
those.
Riding it into is just such a great photo moment. I actually got so busy with my gaming as Christian, I looked around and realized I had taken no photos of the night.
How dare
and
you.
And of course, Ryan took no photos. You know. No
yeah, I get in the moment, man. I need a. If you're at SoCal, well, in the past, listening to this, and you want to carry my phone around and take photos, that'd be great.
Just hire a videographer to do this for you. Floor
he is a videographer.
This is also yeah, it's true.
Get yourself a GoPro, Ryan. Take some stills from it.
Just get a forehead GoPro.
So oh, then when you crouch down to the table to find that line of sight to snipe somebody with, the camera will also get it.
That's right.
And we can hear all the gibberish.
Does this spider droid antenna get over the barricade? Maybe. We don't know.
Then we can go pull all that audio that just infuriates Tim. Yeah,
that's,
yeah.
Right. That's right.
I hear what you're saying, but and Tim's just like,
listen, can we agree that I'm going to take this point? Are we cool with that? Yes.
Listen, friend, I'm just going to tell you.
Yeah, it's like a game of TI playing out. Like, hey, I know you're right here, but I'm just going to take that system, all right? That's good with you? All right, listen, good. That's what's happening. Here it is.
You're agreed that you're going to give me this VAP,
and if you say
right?
anything,
you can't defend this VAP.
If you say anything, you're the jerk. There you go. You're the a-hole. That's...
Hey, Tim, how many games of TI have you won?
One. Thank you.
Oh, wow. Oh. You're playing TI without me?
Don't worry about it.
Man, Tim's got to go find random homeless people on the street to beat at TI. That's what I'm hearing.
So be sure to check us out on the Instagram at STABcast.
Be sure to also check us out on the Facebook and the Twitter and subscribe on the Spotify and rate us on the iTunes. We appreciate whatever you can do to help us boost our brand. We got to get out there, folks. Yeah.
That's right.
There's only been 83 episodes of this crap, and you're still right? going,
we're
damn
still
it.
Here.
Listen,
we're still here.
We are well loved by at least
we're
dozens.
Still
dozens
here.
Of you like
dozens
posts
of
on
people.
The Facebooks.
Yeah. Dozens.
Listen, when we said that we were missing a week, lots of people were sad. All 10 of them were like, yeah. kind of sad.
I appreciated all the jokes about, oh, so it's like normal content. Nothing. Yeah. It's very true.
You can also find us on the Legion Discord. We are at STABcast, whatever our name is.
I'm
I've
Will.
There. I'm trying to poke in more and more. I've been kind of absent just because nothing's really been going on. Sorry, but like Legion-wise,
you're boring so
there's not been a whole reason for me to be there. But I've been trying to, you know, dip my toes back in the water of Legion Discording. So we are there if you need us. We're also on streaming services, although neither one of us have streamed in an eternity, yeah, and I don't know when time. I ever will. Yeah. But I'd like to one day. I keep saying that, but you know, one day.
Just keep saying it.
One day. Just like the RRG, soon.
Yeah. Soon.
Trademark. Soon.
If you want to support this terrible endeavor, you can go to teespring.com/store/STABcast and pick yourself up a fanny pack. It's getting hoodie weather out there. Get yourself a nice hoodie.
Get the original Legion fanny pack. Really.
Yeah,
it's true.
Not the OG fanny pack.
It's still the best fanny pack.
It is the best fanny pack. Or you can drop us a line at swstabcast@gmail.com for show topics or questions, concerns. Just checking in on Tim, making sure he's all right. He doesn't read the emails. I'll respond pretending to be Tim. It'll be a good time.
That only works until someone tries to read what you wrote, and then we all know what happens. We all know who.
Yeah, that's probably true. But if you want to hang out with 75% of the STABcast and or plus Brett, maybe, probably not, but maybe.
There's a possibility.
You can come to the New Orleans Open in December.
Which is still spelled
incorrectly.
I'm going
to be the TO. Yeah. we're all going to be there except for Tim. We're not allowing his negative energy to bring down the vibe.
What do you mean negative energy?
Eating good food. We're going to be playing some of the AMG's mini games. We're doing their hunting seasons on Fridays and then a 32-man event on Saturday and Sunday. It's going to be a good time. I think we got like 3 or 4 tickets left. And after SoCal, it's where all of my Legion energy is going. So expect
good
some
Lord.
More cool announcements in the near future. It's going to be fun.
So, Will, do you know what we have now?
The next text is blue.
Could it be the news?
The news!
The news!
It's the news.
The news! It was mentioned on a stream by someone at some point.
Yep. Yeah, we got two little bits of information.
Well, now hold on. There was a painting stream this afternoon. Hot off the presses. And the information from that painting stream is the RRG will happen when it happens. There you go. There's the news.
We'll get there when we get there, damn it.
That's right. It's not their fault. Yeah. They want to release it. It's fine. It's LFL. But anyway, we'll talk about that more in a minute. But anyway.
Yeah.
Sure.
The things we know, Han is getting an update, which is sorely, sorely, sorely needed.
Oh, my God.
He's getting the steady keyword.
You can steadily go to hell.
I get it. I do. Like, it gives him an extra action to go do some things.
So yeah.
Go to hell.
I still don't know if it's a fix that... Ryan and I have talked about this.
Yeah, we've talked about this quite a bit.
Yeah. The disengage is probably the better fix here.
Well, let's talk about what steady does first. So steady, as you guys know, moves, gets an attack. Han's problem has never been his ranged attack, because his melee attack is so good at 3
right. Oh, I'm just saying. Important to note.
Han's biggest problem has always been he's incredibly good in his element. But his kryptonite, the way to shut any Han down is just put anything at all, whether it's two troopers or a lightsaber, doesn't matter what it is, just put that in base to base with him, and he's 100 points of hot garbage. Because it turns off all of his cool abilities. He's got 3 white dice to melee attack with, and he can't disengage, he can't get away, none of his command cards give him a way out. And so he has to get super close in order to be not only just good, but to be usable at all, because he only has a range 2 gun. It's not like he's got a bad range 3 gun and then a really good range 2 gun. It's to do anything at all, he's got to get himself in the danger zone, which is super easy to counter by just throwing him into melee. So what Steady's going to allow you to do is you're going to get to play Peekaboo Han, where you're going to try to hopefully find some line of sight blockers within range 2 of your opponent's army, hide behind it, step out, shoot, step back in. And I think that's going to be the only really viable way to make Han work. And as we've seen with Cassian and K2 and their teamwork abilities and some of the other, it's not teamwork by name, but some of the cool clone abilities, not having any real token generation outside of his one pip, it makes teamwork and the ability to really take Chewbacca kind of non-existent at all. I think it makes Han, it's certainly not a nerf to Han. It's certainly good for Han, but I think it doesn't help his overall problem of just getting shut down as soon as you get into melee. What I really would have loved to see, Ben kind of alluded to it, is I would love to see either A, disengage because he's a smuggler and he's really good at sliding, you know, out of situations, or B, give him versatile on his weapon. I mean, we literally see him sitting at a table with Greedo and he shoots him with his gun. Doesn't use karate.
If he's so good at disengaging, then why didn't he disengage from Kylo? What happened there?
He wanted to be engaged with Kylo.
Oh, he got disengaged. I was about to say,
if you watch that movie,
and that mortal coil,
Han Solo turned the lightsaber on. There's my episode 7 fan theory.
Okay.
Ooh.
He knew what he had to do.
He didn't, but that's fine.
Anyway, but no, I don't. I think Steady.
We can all agree that Greedo shot first, right?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Wait. What? Wait a minute.
Get out of here. Go play with your Klingons in the corner. Need some paste. Yeah.
That's right. We went real elementary school with that one. We can all agree that Greedo definitely shouted McClunky before he died.
Oh, God.
Is Steady going to bring... Is a nice Han fix? I do. Yeah. I actually do like it.
Do you think it's going to bring him back to the table, though?
At 100 points? Because remember what Han did back in the old days.
If he survived to late game, he was a nightmare.
He's the cleanup crew.
He's your cleanup crew. So you spend the first couple of rounds hiding him until it's time to bring him out and let him clean the board up. Because all those cores drop dead. I mean, with that weapon, shooting Mandalorians, don't get me wrong, they'll have the impervious, but that's
yeah,
still
they're not going to die.
Damage.
What are you talking about?
I think they will. I mean... They just get to roll extra red dice. That doesn't mean they actually, you know,
no, but
spin the pierce.
They're going to have a dodge token, so you're going to cancel one of his two hits.
Yeah. I was going to say, as someone who was just playing against the Mandos the other day with a, you know, pierce two saber, nope, still didn't kill him.
So. Yeah. Yeah, and the pierce two saber had a much bigger die pool than just two
exactly.
red dice.
Exactly.
He's going to sneak up on that bus. Pop, pop.
Sneaky. The other thing that I think the best way to play Han right now is in the Landspeeder, and this does nothing for Landspeeder Han.
Oh, what? Sure. I mean, it does nothing. If he hops out, he can still hop out and get a free attack.
Does it trigger off of a disembark?
It doesn't matter.
It didn't trigger anymore.
Just don't move twice, and you can still just get out and then move. And then
but
you still
no,
get
I mean,
shot.
This update doesn't do anything for Landspeeder Han. Like, giving him steady... So I don't know. I think I really would have loved something rather than pumping him to play a very particular way where you're having to hide behind stuff, and play him very cautiously, or just measure him and do some real, you know, trigonometry and geometry where you're get him to exactly range two, so he's not in charge distance because range is slightly farther than a speed two move. But you're not going to be able to do that with all of your opponent's army, and you really want two units at range two of Han. I really would have loved to seen something that made him less dead on arrival in melee. And long
like
shot,
long
gun. Shot would have even done that. Yeah. Oh, so, but I also can see how giving him versatile or even disengage even more so could make him really scary in the fact that he's now getting into the mix and. Being able to shoot out of a melee, but then being immune to ranged attacks himself. Like, I get that, but this... I don't know that this is going to help the core. As someone who's played a lot of Han, you get someone engaged with him, and he just falls apart. And this doesn't help his range, and this doesn't help him get out of those situations. Maybe we'll get an update and an errata on some of his command cards. I would love to see maybe his one pip give him disengage. That'll go a long way to where maybe you don't have it all the time, but you have an out.
It's the thing that AMG and FFG you can do print more cards. Like FFG started doing that towards the last bit of their reign of X-Wing, and it was nice. I bought some card packs, immediately had some nice things I could do with models I already owned.
Yeah,
I agree.
I mean, do it.
Do what must be done.
We'll see. Do you guys think this will bring Han back to the table? Or are there just too many better rebel options?
I think you'll see more of Han, but I don't think you'll see a lot of Han. How about that?
Yeah.
That's fair. I mean, it's useful, but it's not.
Yeah. I think you'll see more of him. I don't think you'll see a lot of him.
Yeah.
So. Which, but that's, I'd rather they do a small tune than do an overtune where he's like, everybody's bringing Han.
Yeah.
Sure. I get that 100%.
We'll see him in Cad Bane numbers. So less than 10.
Zero. But yeah, the elephant in the room.
Hi.
You mean the thing I have been praying for quite some time?
Yeah. Will, would you like to make a proclamation? Maybe perhaps your final proclamation from your clone throne?
You may think you've struck me down, but I will become more powerful than you can possibly imagine. My Wookiees shall blot out the sun.
It's where you put in the Yoda quote of no. There is another. And it's him. Yoda is the other, but that's fine.
Yoda and Wookiees. Yeah, Wookiee chief. And Obi.
Ben, would you like to deliver the line of what may have just happened?
Clones Delenda Est.
And there was much weeping as Rome fell.
There was gnashing of teeth. There was much rejoicing in the halls of the CIS.
There was much rejoicing. And really all the halls
didn't cry when they killed Rome.
It wasn't the Huns, but okay. Moving on.
Whatever. Which fine.
No, there's a difference. Is this okay? Anyway, the clones have been nerfed. Yes.
Clones can only share one token per attack or defense.
Yes. Yep, per pool, sort of instance, Hallelujah. Whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
Yeah. No more rerolling a Z6 into 10 hits or spending 6 surges and 3 aims. You know, the good times.
the good
The defining feature of our faction, yeah.
they were able to generate so many tokens. And their command cards then gave them more tokens. They just had the ability to shake more out.
I'm not disagreeing with you.
Yeah. I think this would be a good fix. I know there was a lot of gnashing of teeth, like, oh, the faction is dead. There were some of that.
Some of that. But this also makes Fluttercraft and Wookiees and supports and things that don't have the clone trooper keyword makes them playable.
Yeah.
Which I think I'm really excited to see what.
It's that point we made a lot of it's, you know, well, that's neat, but it's not, you know, a clone trooper. So I'm hoping that argument will become less defining.
Yeah.
Is sure. Upside.
No, I think when this happens, like, Wookiees are in the picture. Like, Wookiee Chieftain, I think, actually. It's very good at this point.
Oh, yeah. And not to, you know, say I was prepared for it or whatever, but I've not really played the clone stack, you know.
Sure.
Snipers.
Yeah, that was never all those other things. That was like, never your style. Yeah,
I tried Clone Fort a few times. It's like, this is kind of boring. So I've played Weird Clones for a while now. So it's it's not going to affect me as much, I don't think.
Sure. That's fair.
Like, you know, Tim and I played clones differently, for instance.
Fair.
And Tim had a very good point at the beginning of the show that I think this is, or I mean, this, Tim said it. I mean, you're going to bring Padme back.
Yeah.
Exemplar on Padme.
Yeah. Oh, Anakin, absolutely. Exemplar is very good because it doesn't have that limitation.
Right. Yeah. It's going to make Exemplar way better and way more worthwhile because sometimes, I don't think anyone's ever said that Padme, well, I shouldn't say anyone, I'm sure someone has. Most people can agree that Padme is solid. It's just the amount of points you're paying for her a lot of times just doesn't seem to pay off. But
you're not getting as much action out of it because you had so many other actions on cheaper
units. Correct. But in this case now with this change, like, yeah, okay, Padme is amazing. Anakin is still Anakin, but he's a little bit better, you know, it's an interesting change, right?
He's like, going to add where we used to compare him like as a cannonball type character.
Yeah.
Who's powering up. He now becomes, once you get his 3-pip down, a really big utility piece, and maybe a utility piece that even rivals Rex.
That's what I was playing him as when I had him. And, like, it was really effective back then, even. So I can imagine it still being effective. I think, kind of like Ryan said, I think he hit the nail on the head, like, it's a fix that's a bit heavy-handed, and I thought it was a little bit rough at first, but then I thought about it, I like it better now, I'm more okay with it. But it really makes the rest of the faction playable, right? Like, it makes the rest of the faction playable, and it makes you want to spend the extra points and the extra slots or whatever, what have you, for those units that surge hit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or surge crit.
Because you can't just do it with all the aim tokens. Yeah.
Right. Right. Yeah. So surge hit units just shot up in value immensely. Like Barks were already doing pretty okay right now. And now they're, I think, going to shoot way back up again because now you have this, you know, surge hit platform. It's huge. I think phase two, someone said, like, well, there goes phase twos. No, I think phase twos are way more valuable now because they have their own surge token.
You know, they bring their own surge token to the party. And, like, Courage 2 Core is still really good.
Yeah. And my
someone who wishes they had Courage 2 Core units.
Right. Yeah. Hey, same.
You can for Empire a really measly 16 point upgrade.
God, yeah. The Empire could really use that. But my big thing, and I said this before the show, and I've said this in other places too, is that I hope that we don't hit the clones with this bat, but a fair bat, you know. Mm-hmm. And I hope
it's
the bat
not a spiked
isn't also.
Bat.
It's not a spiked bat, exactly. I hope it's not wrapped in barbed wire. And then we hit them with a huge point increase as well. Like, Rex needs to go up. That's fine. I think they said on stream that he's going up to 100.
Rex is going up to 100, so he's now the same as Han. Oh, no.
Yeah, he should be more totally than fair. That, really, but it's fine. Yeah.
I think for what Rex does, you could put him at 110, possibly 120, and be okay.
I think if you look at Rex's command cards and Han's command cards, and you're just like, why are these the same cost?
No. I think 110 is like the sweet spot. But I think I'll take an increase. I'm not going to look the gift clone in the mouth. So, you know, it's fine. But I think it's fine as long as we don't just hit them too hard. Because, again, at the end of the day, no matter what faction I play, I want the whole game to have a good amount of balance to where you can bring whatever you want to bring, but within reason, whatever you want to bring, and I bring what I want to bring, and we can still have a good time and not feel like, oh, you just Rex-starred me to death, or, oh, you just Wookiee-bust me to death.
I can see clones getting hopefully, once again, we don't have the full RRG yet.
Sure.
Getting some of the same treatments. While I think Rebels, the reason Rebels right now, I think, are my favorite faction, and other than the fact that I play them all the time, is they are the most diverse. And I really hope this same treatment comes to the clones, where it's not like, oh, I'm playing a clone list, so I just need lots of of Pierce to get through those red saves and all those tokens. But now clone lists can start to look like a bunch of really different things between Obi-Wan and Anakin and Rex, and even just generic and saber tank lists. Like, you can bring a bunch of different things in that army now.
And then Wookiees and Yoda, too.
Yeah, yeah, once eventually.
I also think you're going to see with the... probably more of the aggressive focus. If you're going to play an aggressive clone list, I think, in the future with this update, again, this is all pending points, so we don't know points. But if you're going to play an aggressive clone list, you're going to bring fire support platforms of some sort, right?
Yep.
Whatever that may be, you have some options now. There's more options coming out. Great. I think the flip side of that means is that if clones aren't spending their actions on aims, I think dodges... we'll see more and more dodges, and then also I think we're going to see actually a lot more situational awareness, because the clone castle, ironically, might have just gotten stronger in as far as survivability, at least. Not the firepower.
It'd be much harder to dig them out of that ditch.
Yeah, because now they're like, well, I'm not going to take an aim because I can't share it, so I'm just going to take a dodge. There we go. Boom, done.
Yeah.
Or I can share it, but you know, I can only share one of them, whatever.
Yeah, well, and aims really gain their power when you've got 2, 3, 4 of them to spend to fix all those dice instead of...
And so when you're shooting against any other faction, like, oh, that one guy has an aim, I'm not going to shoot him. I'll shoot the guy without an aim.
Right.
And the clones having one... well, sorry, with the dodge token.
Yeah, I know.
And so if a clone trooper happens to have the one dodge sitting there, it makes it harder to choose a target.
Right. And it's also... it should be noted as well, as, you know, as rough as this sounds, remember, too, you can still spend as many of your own tokens as you want. Like, if you have a unit that has an aim and a surge, you still have potentially two aims if you share someone else's. So it's not like you have nothing.
Right.
You can still stack multiples. And, you know, if you play your game right, you could potentially, if you, you know, have someone with electric binoculars or something, or, you know, if there's a future clone unit that gives out aims, you could have a phase two with a surge token, two aims by itself, and not even counting sharing. So, yeah. Or two surges or something like that, you know, whatever. So I think they're far from dead. I think there's just going to take a lot of rethinking. But I think, again, I think at the end of the day, it's going to be less offensive faction, more defensive, which is fine. I don't think that's a bad thing.
Especially for the elite army list,
okay.
Where every body matters so much more.
Right, right.
Oh, yeah, I'd agree with that, too. And I think it, while it's going to be more defensive, I think you can also pivot away from certain things that have been kind of like staples. Like, I don't think aggressive tactics is as useful.
You know? I would think it's more useful, honestly, but...
I don't know. It feels like you'd have... you just have extras if you're also bringing phase two, you know?
I guess, but...
because you can only spend one surge at a time.
Well, no, you can only share one surge token at a time.
So you can spend yours and someone else's. Things. Yeah,
that's what I'm saying. Yeah, yeah. So
if you happen to have two because you're phase two, plus you get to share with buddies, you've got three surge tokens.
It's really what it is more than anything is it makes you have to be smart about your token sharing. As you say, this frontline unit that's holding down an objective, they're going to get token priority. Maybe that's a new buzz term. Here you go. Heard it here first. Token priority. There you go. They take token priority, and your units in the back line are either batteries or whatever, even more so than they have been before, because you're not just sharing. Or maybe they're half batteries. Maybe you're going to be more inclined to move dodge now.
Yeah, like I think it lets you do a lot more of that, where it's, you know, in other factions, it's like, well, I moved to where I want to be, and I can't do anything else, so I just dodge for the hell of it. And it's like, well, now I can still do that and kind of be still generating, like, well, I only have this one aim that I took, but that's... you know, plenty right now. So
right.
It's like you're not gonna feel as bad for not having the five aim stack. Like, you know, I used to see stuff like, don't shoot with clones unless you have three or more aims, and it's like, I hate this.
it just felt awful. And then, like, when you would shoot, you'd be like, hey, I did pretty good, but could I have done better here? Like,
right. Did I not min-max this well enough on my action choices?
I only got 15 hits.
Yeah, exactly. I could have gotten 17, but instead just like 13.
Yeah. So I think it's fine.
And I know every time I would like make that point, and Ben would have a little bit more of an aneurysm as I was talking about it. Like, you see, Ben, that was a little inefficient though, because I only got 12 hits, and he's looking at me like, "Oh yeah, really?
Oh, yeah,
I don't have a unit that can throw 12 dice.
not yet.
Yeah. So I think it'll be fine. I think it's a good change. I think it's what needed to happen.
So you will worth the flaw.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. I think it'll be a good change. I do. I'm with it. But my fear is, and this is a minor fear, which is weird because normally we don't have these fears in America. All our game things come to us. We still don't have a whole bunch of units. I've seen that they're out in the wild in Australia now. They're all across Europe. Yep. There are people who are ordering them from Europe in America to get access to them.
Well, they're even in Canada now. So, like, I've had some people offer to bring me things if I PayPal them money to California. And I'm like,
it's very tempting. Good. Yeah.
Well, I mean, there's nothing for the factions that I play. I could, like, I literally just need an upgrade card and a model. Like,
yeah, screw your friends.
Minis.
Yeah.
I'm not real sure what's going on. Like, and you know, there's plenty of articles out there about supply chain and things are snarling up in weird places. It just seems real odd to me. So.
It's
not I'm to just go saying down this huge it's Ben's hole. Fault.
That's right. It's not to Ben's get down a huge rabbit because... hole, but it's a lack of trucks and truck drivers, mainly truck drivers. So
no,
it's...
the Trade Federation has blockaded the states.
No,
ransom we are no to boo. Start a new confederacy of independent systems.
Well, I mean, as our resident New Orleans man, you are a Gungan. This is all true. Everything you say is
it's true.
It's true. He does live underneath the swamp.
So, but yeah. No, it's a we'll see. And I think we could locally go through some struggles if we get the RRG, and I don't think this is the reason they're holding it back at all, but like if the new RRG is balanced around these new units being in play, we could get a really wonky meta for a couple of weeks until whenever the boats arrive with Yoda and Wookiees and spider droids and magna guards.
I don't think that's at all the case because the RNG's never.
I really don't think they're related, but I do think they could affect. Like it could be an effect where some stuff gets real strange because things are balanced around a state of the game that we don't have access to.
The RNG.
Shame
never,
if I played with empty blank bases.
It's never been that reactive.
X-Wing all over again.
It's just not that reactive.
Right.
It takes in too theory, much time. But... Clearly, it takes too much time to get these things processed, so they don't have the time to go through all that. So no, I don't think so.
And this is the general naysayer in me. I do worry that we have perhaps too much news. Like
too early,
we've had some gigantic news drops over the past 2 months, but we don't have a lot to show for them yet.
No.
And if this is our news about the things we're getting supposedly soon, then what happens to things we've been predicting?
Right.
Like the mini extravaganza predicts out a year and a half, and that may be.
Yeah, you're right, Ben.
I mean, you posted a very nice GIF today about what the AMG Twitch is about. And mostly it's people complaining about not having the things and not getting the things. And it can dry up. It can dry up players sometimes.
It is, and it's frustrating, like, on the content creation side, because really we should be sitting here talking about, oh, well, I'm still learning how to play with Magna Guard or with Yoda or, you know, something like that.
Out Gary the Snail and someone shot him and I was really mad and I meowed at them.
It's all these conversations that should be happening that keep the game going of like, oh, this new thing came out, so I'm trying this out. And I do not like it, but this other guy brought the new thing and that's fine. And we're not able to have those conversations, and it's stalling, and it's hard. And again, it's really not anyone that's directly involved with us. It's not their fault. Like, it's not AMG's fault on the RRG. Like, they're not holding it up. They've been that very clear. It's not their fault that we can't get our toys, because that's the supply chain issue. Like, it's just, it really is a case of, I hate the saying, but it's true. It is what it is. Like, it's just the way it is. There's, there's no one's head that has to roll for it. It's just... we're stuck.
Yep. We're just stuck.
We're just here.
In the ether.
Until we're not here. So, Ryan, this weekend, actually the weekend passed, and you're listening to this recording on Wednesday.
Yeah, you're listening to this.
You are going places where the rest of us are not.
I am. Man, when we sit down at the beginning of every year as the Stabcast, and we plot out to make sure we are represented everywhere, and it came down to the fact that one of us had to go to California, to San Diego. I fell on my sword for you all.
Really?
You were taking this one? Yeah.
Such a blow.
You poor thing. You
know? If SoCal had been this past weekend, you know, the 16th, I could have gone. Had it been October 1st, yeah. I could have gone.
Yeah. So yeah, I'm flying to San Diego to play some Legion with some people, I guess. And I have not had a ton of time to practice. Invader League has been over. Round Robin, we are in a long break as we hopefully wait for a new RNG that's looking bleaker and bleaker by the day. We've got a couple days left. Of our recording tonight on the 20th of October.
No.
We've got 2 days for SoCal. If the new the new rules drop between now and then, we're going to use them. If not, we're not going to. So this has been an interesting event to plan for.
Yeah.
And I will say, we have traditionally on this podcast been the harbinger of news in that we will post an episode and then news drops. And we immediately look like fools because we're 2 weeks behind all the news cycles. And we have actually been on top of the news cycle over the past 4 months or so.
Yeah.
And so maybe that's what's wrong. We have tempered with the cosmic good.
Maybe so.
Maybe. So hopefully us posting this episode will pull the RRG out of the ether. We will will it.
Maybe.
To be.
I continue to doubt.
X.
So
it'll happen one day. It's fine.
Tomorrow we will finalize what version of the rules we are playing with for SoCal. And then I believe Saturday we're going to finalize what version of the rules we are using for Invader League. Although Invader League is allowing some of the new models that have been out in other countries. But for the points and rules reference update. So it's an interesting time to try to list build, to say the least, at least in a very competitive sense. What do I take is where I have found myself, and what is this meta in this very unique time gonna look like?
You're gonna see a ton of droids in Maul.
Yep.
Like, lots of droids guarantee in it. Maul. Call it a day. You'll probably see a double tank or two.
Yep. Okay.
Like there'll be some of those floating around, so guarantee that. Mark it down.
Lots of B2s.
Lots of B2s. So you'd be tons of B2s. Good luck at range two.
So at the Dallas Open, not the Lone Star Open, but the Dallas Open in Atlantic City, there were a lot of Rec Stars, but then people didn't want to play it at Lone Star because this is going to be the last hurrah of Rec Star. Do people bring it?
I think so. I think you may see some of that.
I mean, a couple.
I think so. I think, you know what, all the there's been a lot of press around this. I think you're going to see more Obi-Wan.
Okay.
I think you're going to see more and more people are getting turned on to Obi-Wan, and I think you're going to see him coming out to play.
What do the Rebel lists look like, do we think?
All over the place, buses. All the time.
Buses. The only flavor is going to be, what do you put in the bus? Is it going to be going to be Wookiees? Is it going to be Fleet Troopers?
It doesn't matter what you put in the bus because it's good. So there you go.
Yep. Yeah. I don't know if anybody's putting Mando in buses.
No, they should not.
Next to the bus.
Don't do that. Yeah.
They go next. They go behind the bus. Sure. So I've been think tanking with Colkey down in Australia and a couple other people. I think what I want to take is double airspeeder.
Okay.
Oh, Lord.
I think.
Okay.
I think it answers a lot of those issues. I think it eats buses for breakfast because you can double tap a bus and with some good dice probably chew them down. If not at the top of, you know, when they move during turn one, definitely with the compulsory moves working the way they do now, definitely turn two, getting a bus.
You are stealing the list that Floor brought to LSO.
So, yeah, when I said I wanted to bring double airspeeder, you definitely pointed that out to me, which meant I immediately had to change it. But now, Florf ran, he went full armor skew with triple RT, correct? So he had two airspeeders, triple RT?
I believe so, something that vein in. And Sabine to throw some bombs in.
A Sabine to throw some bombs. So when you brought that up, I was like, well, I can't take Artie's now.
Yeah, because if you won with Floor's list, you could never say that you won with your list. And so
right, exactly, exactly.
That's what it's about. Definitely.
And so keeping that idea in mind, the T-47s are going to keep buses at bay. They're going to deal with single tank really, really well. They're not going to deal so well with double AAT. So I got the idea in my head, what if we went some Pathfinder, or not Pathfinders, excuse me, some Rebel Vets and the Mark II? Because a Mark II fire supporting an airspeeder sounds really, really, really good. I've heard Surge
I like
crit
it, and now
adding
I hate
dice
it.
To it.
As someone who's done it, it's pretty good.
It's pretty good.
Would recommend.
I've not actually played it. This is a list that if the RRG doesn't update and I get all this built and painted the few missing pieces I have, I'm planning to take it. But as much as I loved what I was doing, I did want to throw some Pathfinders in here because this list originally, when I sent it to Cole Key, had Pathfinders
whoa,
with
whoa,
Biston.
Whoa. Hang on.
Yes.
You have been conspiring with the Australians on this list?
Yeah, absolutely.
You're telling me that this list has a whiff of some kind of platypus, a wallaby?
I send you guys list, and you guys are like, A, probably don't open it except for Brett. And if you do, all the critical feedback I get is I hate it. So,
I mean, yeah, what does that tell you?
What does that tell you?
That exactly. I have awful teammates and friends, so okay. I went to, hey, okay. to smart people.
I don't like your criticism,
value
so
my
I reject
success.
It. Goodbye.
Okay. Who value my success.
Okay.
So you turned to things. This dingo in the desert and was like, what do you think about this list, dingo?
And so I sent him a version of the list that had... it may have had some rebel ion troopers in it. I think three of them, and my goal was to pump out four ion tokens a turn with two airspeeders.
That was the list you and I originally talked about.
Yes.
You and I had talked about that list.
And Colkey talked me off the ledge. God bless him.
But you understand why when you post a list like that, the rest of us go, that's terrible. And not in an I hate it kind of way, but like, come on, four ions? Come
yeah.
on.
Yeah. But then he offered constructive, helpful criticism. And what are some things, Ben, if we think we're going to see a lot of Maul and B2s, what are some things you don't want to see across the table?
From Maul, anything with Pierce.
Yep.
I mean.
Well, Maul doesn't care about Pierce.
No, Maul
B2s doesn't. Hardly care about Pierce.
Oh, then B2s.
B2s do. They absolutely care about Pierce.
they care about Impact. Do they really care about Pierce, though? Okay.
I figured, have RR1. So when you roll a single white die, if you can't block it, well, then suddenly you've lost a body.
Yeah. I usually think of Pierce being more valuable against red saves, but.
No, it really, because
the Pierce 1 is just like, one. Pierce 1 is just the little insult to block their one, to cancel their one block they've rolled in that pool. It's like, well, exactly. At least I blocked one so a B1 didn't die, and you're like, nope.
So I had heavy cover, and I had armor, so I took away three of them. You still had, because they're clones, whatever, three more hits against me. I roll my three white dice, I go blank, blank, and then, hey, look, I have a surge, which I spend my one reliable token on, and you're like, I pierced the one. Well, biscuits.
Shouldn't have spent the surge. That's a you problem.
I usually remind them.
So, what is Maul? If you say Pierce, what does Maul not like to see?
Big dice pools. Big dice pools are bad.
Other force users.
Okay. Well, I don't have any of that. I do have big dice pools. I do have. I have Rebel Pathfinders.
So you kind of do though, because you
can get a big dice pool.
Big die pools or. Accurate die pools, like an airspeeder.
Yeah,
yeah. No, that's
I mean,
the hope
airspeeder
to...
that comes around the corner and shoots Maul. I'm super afraid of.
If and then a second one does it, he's probably dead.
Yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong. Maul can throw his lightsaber at it. Whoa, 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 whoa. I mean, but
and it'll be like
bring the saber throw, wounds. Everyone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it'll have some impact. I'll get two, and I'll probably have the Pierce two, and you're likely, like I said, I'll get two through.
Like I
but
said,
then you
two.
Still have. Yeah.
Yeah.
So my idea was to deal with force users, maybe not just so much Maul, but I think we will see an uptick in force users. I don't, after double airspeeder and to stay at 10x, I don't have the points for a Jedi myself, obviously.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to go all the way up to Sabine. So I took a set of Mando Resistance with the Beskad Duelist and a comms jammer.
I like that plan.
It's not going to win the fight against the Force user, but with Shriv piloting one of my T-47s, it's a pretty good dodge target for Shriv to kind of pal around with. They're both pretty fast and can stay near each other.
Yep.
If I can just stymie it and not let it kill my airspeeder and not let the force user rip apart the soft underbelly of my army and just kind of slow it down for two, three turns. Just
slurp out the crab meat.
Mm-hmm. I think Mando's there do that for me. And the other thing they do for me is I've got Biston Pathfinders, two T-47s, and jetpack rockets on the Mandos. If you're bringing armor and you get within range 4 of my army, that's terrifying turn 1.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to hope my goal here is to kind of be able to pick something up pretty early off the table and ride some momentum to victory. Because even a clone fort, I don't have the pierce, but I'm hoping that if I can just focus down one or two big targets with two airspeeder shots, Pathfinders, 13 dice, and Mando rockets, especially if there's a big armor, which I expect to see a lot of armor at this event.
I mean, the Alpha is going to be pretty good, but it will be. I mean, you bring a medium two blaster and a veteran, and you're bringing Biston, because of course you're bringing
Biston. I think your big thing that you're afraid of here is melee. Sure. I think we said it already, but you know, like it's, I know your Mando's
no, there. I agree.
They have the duelist, but the problem is that's only one unit, and I don't know.
They're only one health, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're only one health. They theoretically are going to be pierce immune as long as Shriv is doing his job.
Sure, sure.
Right. But
but that's the thing is like it's I'm running a bunch of big, expensive rebel things, and that may ultimately be my undoing with Paths, Mandos, and two T-47s all well above 100 points.
Right.
Hang on. But then who's your leader? Like,
well, I've got Shriv. I do have Shriv.
Okay, if I need to. Okay.
But I was also looking at shenanigans because, God, I love shenanigans. Mm. I'm thinking about taking Lando.
Yeah, I see that. I think Lando's solid, though. I think he's a good
his
support
piece. His 2-pip can order vehicles. He can get my airspeeder's dodge tokens with his 2-pip. Yeah. I believe it's not trooper restricted for the ability.
I mean, if something
I can
too
pull
close,
a token out of the bag when I need to.
Yep. If something gets too close, he's good at fighting stuff off, you know? Like, he can be okay. I mean, he's weak health-wise. Sure, he can get punked off the board. But I think you have enough tricks that kind of help keep him alive, like kind of like Han. But because I think Lando is Han plus.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah, the sharpshooter too. He is my only source of pierce. Mm. But for picking off unit leaders is going to be kind of his goal to go late in the round and pop out from behind a corner and get a unit leader. And it's going to let me take three command cards with contingency.
Yeah.
So I'm going to have lots of options. I am also taking R2, so I'll have access to R2's cards.
Doesn't the Beskad Duelist give you Pierce as well?
It gives me Duelist, so if I spend an aim token, I can get Pierce 1.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying, so you have an optional possible Pierce if you need it. If you need it.
Yeah, if they're not fighting something, if you're...
I know. It's not what you normally are going to do, but I'm saying if you need it, you
have it. Their goal is if there's a lightsaber to go after it. If I need it in melee.
So, riddle me this, Batman. Sure. Why don't you drop Lando, pick up a second set of vets, and another Mark II medium blaster?
Command card.
Gives you 11 activations. No Lando, but it gives you 11 activations, more firepower. You have a guy who can become your commander if Shriv dies. Who has, you know, Courage 2. Well, that's in your Mark 2 medium blasters.
So,
you can double the fire support options. So you can fire support twice from your T-47s because you're a B. I mean.
No, you're probably not wrong. I don't think those Mark 2s, those vets will have the heavies on them. The one I currently am running doesn't. It's literally just there to get me the Mark II and hopefully toss it in order.
Ugh.
It's for his command cards. I don't want to go in with nothing but generic command cards. Well, I don't have R2s. But being able to take 9 command cards sounds real, real fun.
I'd also recommend fire supporting Lando with the Mark II. It's pretty cool.
Yes. if the opportunity presents itself. But that is an interesting thought. That definitely is an interesting thought. But it also gives up some of my Pierce ability.
So here's the thing. Like, Idiot's Array sounds super cool and fun. I don't think it does enough damage to make it worthwhile, if I'm just going to be real honest with you.
That's fair.
So there's one pip doesn't do a lot.
I've,
Ace up the sleeve is nice.
Gunslinger on a sharp 2 unit at the end of the game is pretty good.
With a black-red die? I mean, I know you got sharpshooter 2, but you're praying he's alive and close enough.
It's for picking up activations at the end of when you're going to kill points.
You remember what my Lando did to you, Ben?
Lando didn't do anything, remember? That was the problem.
No, he picked off a couple B1s when it mattered on those key key points.
As we were running towards a thing, this is true.
He finished off units so that they didn't score a kill point. Or,
and remember,
key
too,
positions.
Lando, I could be wrong here because I really can't recall off the top of my head. Is Lando range 3?
Yes, he is.
Yeah, so I mean, that helps too. That helps that whole problem as well.
Yeah, and also I think Lando will be pretty survivable just because he is such a low die pool.
He's not a huge target, but I also had a lot of...
you're going to want to go after the Mandos or the T-47s or hell, maybe even the Pathfinders first.
It was odd because when I played Lando in the tournament, it was just like he just would not die. Like, people would shoot at him a bunch and that reroll would mean enough that he wasn't dead. So they wouldn't want to shoot him again, and they'd get frustrated at that. You know,
The other reason I like Lando in this list is access to improv orders, which I ended up taking.
It's also
really going to help
improv orders. I get that
because my bag is a little all over the place. I've got a handful of core. I got four core.
Four core.
One commander, one operative, two heavy, two special forces. So making sure I can activate those T-47s when I want to. Is going to be pretty clutch.
I get it, but again, this is a play style difference we talked about earlier.
Yeah,
in the episode.
And this I would is go why with I wanted to talk here. To you guys about it. Okay,
I really would, because one, it puts you up an extra activation. It gives you another rebel vets, which is going to surge for those black dice, which are still really good.
Yeah,
and another place where you can fire support, and your command cards are going to give you all sorts of order tokens. I mean, even if you happen to use R2-D2's 3 pip because you wanted to, it still gives a token to him and to another trooper unit, which then gets to be bounced to a Mark II, giving you 3 and a smoke bomb if you wanted it.
The other reason that I'm hesitant to not take a commander at all is Shriv is not going to probably be with the rest of my army.
And that's, yeah.
Not after the first couple turns.
And so, having Lando to be able to sit back and hang out with my troops and keep them from panicking off the board, or covert opsing in and letting Biston do that, was a concern of mine.
I get that, but yeah. You could convert that to a little generic guy, giving yourself another rebel veteran, and convert one of your rebel troopers into a Mark II. You still can get the same activation count with an actual commander.
Sure.
If you want to go with the generic.
I don't know. You may be right here.
I like
my
Lando.
Other concern.
I like Lando in there. I like Lando in there. I think Lando's the right call. But
my other concern is
playing. Go ahead.
Yeah, I definitely do too. It's definitely something to chew on.
Yeah.
My other concern is I built this list originally for Invader League for single limbs with knowing that we're going to do a 4-card flip, red player pick side. I'm at $7.99. How bad is this list if we're doing 3-card flip, blue player pick side?
The more thumbs rebels have, the more likely you're going to run, do the objectives, and kill enough things to stay alive.
So I've got 8 thumbs. Well, no, I've got 7 thumbs.
So, but bombing run comes at you, you don't care. Got it. Thanks. Appreciate it.
Yeah. I got R2 and two T-47s. Yeah.
Hostage exchange would be harder for you, but you do have Mandalorians. Like I said, you can put it on a Rebel Vets to get through.
Yeah.
For the courage and the defense. I mean, it's I think you're okay with, because just think about what you're likely to see. Sabotage, you got that.
Right.
If they happen to play recover supplies against you, that's just silliness on their part.
Right.
R2 is going to run out to this box and grab it and possibly get secret mission at the same time. Thanks, guys. Extra points. I think
that's true. I think maybe I just struggle against payload, which not a lot of people play.
Not a lot of people play it.
Yeah. And partially because at a tournament like this, you have to bring those extra pieces with you. Like, it's something you also pack in your bag when you're flying out.
Yeah.
I mean, I think you're okay with whatever. I can't think of something else that somebody's bringing. I mean, Tim, in your battle decks, what are you bringing that this deck would hate?
Anything? I mean,
what? Disarray?
Yeah. That's, I'm going through my
head. I'm fine with Disarray. I put the T-47s in one box and everything else in the other. Like, and Bist in wherever the hell he wants.
right? I can't think of anything that like, I'm like, ah, I got him. Ha ha.
I'm on Tabletop Admiral right now just running through stuff. Like, I don't see a place where...
I mean, even if you get stuck with Long March... I might
struggle with Intercept.
Yeah.
Long March, just because my T-47s are good at pushing you off of things. Oh, Long March is great for this list.
Well, as long as you don't run your T-47s in there before the rest of your army, it's fine.
Yeah.
Right. But even I've got, like, Bistin, who can range 4 poke. Like, I think I need to get more conservative with my Bistin and play more at range 4. I love to get him close at range 3. But I don't have the HQ uplink. I don't have the duck and cover. I don't have Cassian's refresh to give Bistin a free recover. So I'm definitely going to have to play Bistin more cautious than I normally do. And he's really going to have to be there for this ion impact nonsense. But if 70% of the lists I come up against are going to have armor in them, I kind of like my odds.
Yeah, I think it's fine. I think it's a fine list.
Awesome, I think so. I mean, you and I disagree on the core pieces, but I also understand why Lando. I do. Because, I mean, like Will said, he used it exactly against me. I had some B1s running, and Lando was like, two, and then B1s were dead. I mean,
yeah.
I get it. So, I mean, I do. I do get that list.
I guess the only list I really fear, and why I asked, I kind of led with the question earlier, Rex Star scares me with this.
Rex Star scares everyone, pretty much. But I think you're fine.
I don't have all the Pierce that I'm used to.
Yeah, but you just shoot them. You'll be fine.
Just fly a T-47. Just put both T-47s into something you want to die, and it'll be hopefully neutered. Or maybe Surge die crit. If they rolled real bad.
You're fine.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
So
that T-47 is so good.
Yep.
So
good.
And with the changes to speeder rule, like, you can go exactly how far you want to be, do when you want to do it. I mean...
Remember the days when T-47s were bad? I remember that. It was a good time.
Yeah, there were a lot of those days.
I prefer that they're good.
No,
I'd rather see them around.
Yeah.
Like, they were a joke, Tim. It's like an 8. That's fine. You know, it's like a Gav tank.
That's fine. I'm fine that my sworn enemy has a joke. That's okay.
Oh, Tim.
I think you're fine with it. I really do. Like, I think it'll go to places and do the things.
So there's one problem with this list. Actually, two. I'm worried about transporting the T-47s because I am flying in those bases. I have one terrible coat of paint on one of my T-47s and one that's unbuilt and unpainted.
You're fine.
Will, as our resident paint experts, what do I need to do to speed paint an airspeeder out?
Are we talking three-color minimum here?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean... We're talking Ryan's finger painting ability of paint.
All right.
Like,
so,
I would like it to look halfway decent.
But in this case, the best way to do that would be, I mean, if you're talking the quickest way, build the other one, spray paint it white, then take both, paint the windows black and the guns silver. Done.
I mean, you can throw enough red specks at it to make it, you know, camouflage like you hit flying geese.
If you want to put some actual care into it, you know, T-47s are pretty easy on the painting job because they are just, you don't even have to paint the bottom, really. You know, that stays white.
Mm. Yeah, that's fair.
The annoying part for me was the big grill on the back because a lot of detail you have to push the brush into. Otherwise, it bothered me that I could still see the other paint through it. But they're pretty easy. You could just...
I didn't put the ailerons on mine because they kept breaking off.
Like, I did.
Took the ailerons off
mine. Interesting.
I did. Yeah. The easiest way is just to close them.
Yeah.
You just glue them closed. And the ones on the back, no one would notice if you don't have those. Except me.
That's fair.
no, it's really how much you want to put into them. Like, because you want to use them after this is the issue. So you don't...
Sure.
You don't want them to always be trash.
47s are good.
So... and maybe you don't want the other one to be white, you can just, they can be one color with the windows and the gun detailed and they'll look fine for a T-47. They'll look just fine.
If you do white, the black, like say gray on the gun, some metal color, and then you could always
some kind of silver color.
Easy to do you could easily do a line of red, and then call that a day.
And then slap some Nuln Oil over all the white and the silver.
Yes. Yes.
And then
so it looks quite as dirty as mine, because I did that with mine. It just looks like mine ran through a mud puddle.
Right.
40,000 feet.
So I kind of want to do that with mine, but instead of brown mud, I want like. I'm flying over the salt plains. If anyone's not seen my army, I've got it all crate themed.
Right.
So I definitely do want some red specks kind of all over it. I don't think I'm going to go full glue salt to the edges, but
no, I wouldn't.
Might. Who knows?
Because it wouldn't be sticking on that thing. It's going pretty fast.
Nope. Yeah.
It would just be causing pockmark.
Yeah, it'd be causing weathering and things. The easiest way to do specks is to take your brush and have the model in front of you, brush in your right hand, and just like put your left hand near the model and whack the brush into your hand so that it stops suddenly and paint flies off of it onto your model. Does speckles really well.
Bob Ross, shake the devil
out. Yeah, shake the devil out of it. But speed painting is difficult. It's something I'm actually not great at. I like to go into detail a lot on everything, so I'm very slow. You know, it's really how much you want to put into them versus how much time you have. So the minimum is really easy to get to. It's just how much further you want to go after that. And there's quick things like those speckles or using a wash that can add a lot of detail for not much time.
Okay.
Definitely.
Well, I appreciate it. I'm sure mine will look terrible.
They're refurbished.
The only reason I don't want to take my Lando, the reason he may get pulled, is because my model does. Like, I did a speed paint on it, and I didn't get my colors right at all, and it looks god-awful.
Oh, it's fine.
But let's remember, though, this was a Wave 1 feature, so it's only like four pieces of plastic.
Yeah.
That's true, yeah.
I mean, the hardest part I had with mine is they gave me two left guns, and so one of my guns just glued upside down. In fact, even with the picture I'm looking at, this is just straight from the website. There's like a bit of orange on the back and then an orange stripe down the front, and then it's just all gray and a black
windshield. Yeah, I mean, even the Canon air quotes paint job is white with an orange stripe, you know. I did mine white with one has a pink stripe and one has purple stripes, and then I did the wing edges in the same color. And then I went overboard with a bunch of weathering and things to make it look cooler, because I did like streaks down it because it's moving through and all these other things. So that stuff takes a while. But the basic paint job, it's one of the easier models in Legion to get done quickly. There's no figures on it or, you know, it's not a...
Fair enough.
It's not an X-34.
If you told me you were trying to build a lat tonight, I'd be like, oh.
Oh, you're doomed.
No, no. You can build a lat. Just don't build the inside and it's fine.
This is true.
That's true. It's still a bit of a pain in the ass.
Like, nope, just a lot the of inside. And it was easy. My second one was easiest. If only I had two bases still, but that's okay.
Our new player Christian was like, "How'd you build all those B1s?" And I was like, "I didn't. I paid Wilhelm to do it." So. Yep.
And those
B1s, built everything else but that.
Those B1s turned out pretty well, and they were also probably one of my speediest paint jobs, because I could spray paint them that brown, give them a wash, and then do the detail color in the gun, and it's like, well, that's done.
It's just the assembly. I knew between that and the Droidicas. Those Droidicas,
Droidicas.
The Droidicas were a pain. Staps are not great.
I say now
that I'm sitting here thinking about it, when I get back, if I'm not immortally mad at the T-47, I may have to pay Will to paint an orange, white, and green T-47 for Harrison.
I thought you were going to say for Mardi Gras.
I thought it was going to be Mardi Gras too. I was like,
that's missing purple,
that is purple, green, and gold, sir.
Well, that's like, but he's not Irish. Sorry.
Yeah, that's why I was like, that's my thing. Wait a minute.
I mean, that could be nice.
For the big easy Mardi Gras thing, you know, in December. Yeah.
I will say, a lot of tournaments, especially if they're playing 40 hammers there, they're going to have a 3-paint minimum.
Yeah.
But really, it's not a lot. Like, people freak out about that paint job. And we have players who still play with unpainted minis, and that's perfectly fine. But it's not so bad to get that
3-paint minimum is pretty easy.
Yeah. You can rattle can stormtroopers or clone troopers white and then paint in the black, and now you're halfway there, and then do something nice with a base, and blam, there you go. The gun's a different color. Or you've got pauldrons that you paint to be a different color, or the base, you have squad markings. Like, mm-hmm. Honestly, I felt my clones, or not my clones, my Imperial guys weren't that bad, because it was just a prime it, paint it white with an airbrush, or rattle can, and then the rest was pretty easy.
Yeah. No, I mean, I chose to make my clone painting process a pain in the ass. And then, like a psychopath, I'm making a second clone army.
Yeah.
Oh, gosh.
Because I want a Khajiit clone army, and my orange ones are cool, but I want a different one now.
Okay.
Now, of course, Will says psychopath. Will has great talent, and the clone, remember our clones, have a lot of variation in them. Like, that's one of the things I think that draws people to the clones, also because they're not the fascist empire.
Well, and I've liked that there's...
Allegedly.
You see him in the third prequel movie, there's clones in camo armor, and I was like, that's really mm-hmm. cool, and would be fun to have a whole army of that with, like... You know, more woodsy
bases. So where a normal person would be like, I want to do a squad in each of these different schemes.
Good God, no, that's heresy. I would never do that.
He's like, I've got to go buy 5 saber tanks for my 5 different clone
armies.
Will,
just think, soon you'll have the swamp speeder coming. I say soon. Soon, trademark. You'll have the swamp speeder coming out.
Well, exactly, and so...
You can make them all swamp themed. There you go.
Yeah, it's going to be like, when I'm bringing these newer units, I use these... Because the thought is, I'll need less clone troopers for those builds where I'm bringing swamp speeders or Wookiees or whatever. Okay, so it's like I can do 4 or 5 clone squads and a Rex and a generic commander, and that's all it really needs. Maybe a bark and a bike or something, but bark is a bike, a bark or an AT-RT or something.
An RT, you know, sure.
Yeah, it's just not to replace the entire collection I have. Of what, you know, existing, but if I'm doing that, it'd be kind of cool to have its own thing, and I don't need as many clones to paint for it.
Will painted my TAC droids to match up with the units I was going to put them in, and then he painted a nice special one purple who was going to be the army leader. But if I'm not using my TAC droid as the army leader, I'm using the one that's colored to match the squad they're sitting in.
Sure. That's cool. Yeah.
I mean, I like the idea. I do. It sounds like craziness, but... unless you need a lot of ARC troopers, because good luck finding them.
I've got 2 unopened ARCs on my desk.
All right, fair enough.
I think well, you got it.
when Will starts throwing the clone bling around, I think it's time to end the show. I thought it was going to be when
the clone throne bling.
Yeah.
I mean, are ARCs even that good anymore? I don't know.
Who knows?
No, there's still rock solid. Fuck.
The answer's
always
yes.
I mean, I need a point decrease on ARCs. AMG, I'm gonna need that.
The audience will know by the time this comes out. Probably, maybe, who knows?
Yeah.
So
hopefully we'll have points by the time this drops, and it'll be all mute. And doesn't matter.
That, I mean, that's back on brand for us. Moot. So. I know it's and moot is the word you're looking for.
I know. Oh, don't you correct me, you Polish son of a bitch.
The point is moose.
I can speak well. It's the typing bit we struggle with.
Whoa. Ooh.
He speaks back country gibberish.
True country gibberish.
Genuine hillbilly gibberish.
That's why you and Keith get along.
Well, thanks for listening. Yep. Thanks for listening, everybody. Spending your drive time, your paint time, your quarantine time, whenever it is you bother to listen to us. And until next time, I'm Ryan Slawoski, reminding you that I probably just did really poorly in SoCal.
I'm Will Heim, reminding you to never collaborate with Australians, because you'll do poorly in SoCal.
Only in SoCal, though.
Only in SoCal. Everywhere else you'll do fine.
Oddly specific. I was going to do a business deal in SoCal, but then I talked to the Australians first and just ruined the whole thing.
Yes, Cole Key ruined the deal. He altered the deal.
it's the kangaroo curse is what that is right there.
Yes, indeed.
I'm Tim Hannon, reminding you that Rome was actually sacked in 410 by the Visigoths. I apologize.
The Visigoths,
I misremembered. I apologize. The Visigoths were also fighting the Huns, though, and so that was...
They were around. Yeah.
No, I just read the whole thing. Shut the hell up. I made a mistake. I apologize.
Yeah.
And I'm Ben Fowler, reminding you that the Stabcast always does well when they bring a list they have just created right before they get on the plane. So.
That's true.
That's true.
Soon, when the points are updated, we'll go back to the toilet lists. Am I going to bring this?
Yep.
Nope. I'm sitting here making a new one right now, changing.
Yep.
30 minutes to take off. All
right. Good night. Goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Speaking of the news.
The news.
Oh, what?
The news.
The news.
This is your bit, Will.
News.
Hang on. Oh, did we lose the... We did. What happened to the...
I was waiting for the social media.
The social media plug.
Oh, yeah.
Why didn't you copy it over, Ben? All right.
It wasn't me.
I did copy it over. I'm blaming Ryan. You're the one who deleted most of the middle.
I did nothing here.
I just deleted the pictures.
It's clear.
Yeah. The trick, Will, is to do nothing, and then we can't get blamed.
Let's do the social media plug.
The trick is to drink
more. The social media plug was right before the picture, so I imagine that you... Hang on, I should have reposted that. I don't think we really need to, but you know.
Yeah, I was about to say, everyone should know this by now. We've only been doing this for 3 years.
It is episode 82, or 83, but.
Hello there, cadets and commanders of the Stabcast. This is Mike Cirillo, otherwise known as Ghost Walking from the Legion 99 podcast. And unfortunately, I have to bow my head to Ryan here. We rehashed our bet from our last Invader League season where we saw whose judging pods could finish quicker. And not only did Ryan's pods finish before I did, but he also played all his games first. So we can say that he is clearly the superior judge, as evidenced by his ability to, I guess, somehow squeak into eliminations yet again, despite getting a higher seed than me. I'm not really sure how that happened. But congratulations, Ryan. Good luck in eliminations, and good luck with everything going on with the upcoming frontline events that you are running.